Hello everyone, welcome back. Next up, we have Yogesh Agarwal, an entrepreneur and a leader in emerging technologies working in the educational technology sector. He is co-founder of Zubi, a platform that serves students and professionals with online class materials on subjects such as blockchain, AI, Internet of Things, and many more. With his extensive background in the blockchain space, he will share with us today some of his experiences with blockchain elements. Please welcome to the stage, Yogesh, so you can take it away.
Hi, everyone. Thanks, Sharis. Thanks a lot for the wonderful introduction. And let's start with the workshop today. So I'll just give me a second. Let me just open my presentation. Yeah, I hope it is visible to everyone. Okay, I can begin. Okay, so at first, I'll just give you a brief introduction about myself. So as Sharis said, that my name is Yogesh Agarwal, and I'm a co-founder at Zubi, which is a next generation emerging technology platform on EdTech. So we are preparing the Gen Z towards the new age of technologies, and we are building the largest emerging technology ecosystem. You can join us on Telegram. So I'll be sharing more details at the end of the workshop. And then I'm an Ethereum DEFCON 5 scholar. So if you guys are familiar with the blockchain space, then Ethereum is like one of the largest blockchain ecosystem in the world. And I was selected amongst the top 50 people from around the world and got a chance to interact with the top blockchain leaders at Japan in their conference called DEFCON. So then I have experience in blockchain development and research, wherein I have written a few research papers on healthcare in blockchain and identity management. And I've taught around 1500 students on blockchain technologies yet. So moving ahead, these are a few of the things that we will cover in this workshop. So we'll start with seeing how the existing systems in the world function, then we'll move on to the brief introduction of blockchain and how the concepts of blockchain actually work. Then we'll like do a hands-on on creating a smart contract using Solidity in Ethereum. Okay, so first let's understand how exactly the current world functions, the systems in the world, how they are actually defined. So in the current scenario, almost everything is like based on an intermediary system. So if I were to take an example, take an example of a bank. So suppose you have to send money to someone, let's say your friend, or maybe you bought something from Amazon, you have to pay to Amazon, then there's an intermediary called bank, which is facilitating all these transactions, and you have to go through that particular intermediary. So apart from bank, like it you can see it in every part of our life. So for example, let's say you go to buy some vegetables or some fruits. So to the vendor that you are going, he or she is also an intermediary. I mean, the farmers are growing those particular vegetables and fruits, and they are selling to some other vendor, then it comes to some other, and then finally through a long chain, you get it. Right. So there is an intermediary involved. So intermediaries are not actually bad because they are giving us services. Right, they're making it easy because we can't directly go to the farmers. But the problem comes when the intermediaries start becoming corrupt. Okay, so suppose, for example, your local vendor mixes some of the chemicals in the fruits or vegetables, right? So you will never know that at what part of the chain that tampering was actually done. So similarly, in the case of banks, sometimes banks apply various unnecessary charges for their services, and people have to pay it because they don't have any other choice. So moving ahead, so like these two companies we all know, Google and Facebook. So if we see in our like daily lives, then almost these big giants have conquered mostly all of the things that we do. We have to trust these people. We have to trust them with our data. Google, we always search on Google. Let's take an example of Google Docs. We put, let's say, some important information on that. Then we are trusting these third parties with our important data, that they will keep it secure, they will not misuse it. And if we take the example of Facebook, that then there has been multiple controversies in the past also of Facebook data leaks and all. So like there is an environment where we need to trust other third parties. Okay, and these are like YouTube and LinkedIn. So YouTube is like also quite famous for its censorships. So it like there has been many cases when YouTube just removes certain videos, not because they are vulgar or something, just because YouTube don't like it, you can say. And no one has a say in it because all the authority is in the hands of these third parties on which we are dependent. And on LinkedIn also, I've personally seen many like famous personalities on LinkedIn who are very popular, but they post certain, let's say, controversial posts, and LinkedIn just removes their ID completely without any reason and anything. So like these things are pretty wrong because these third parties should not be having this much authority. Okay, so this is just a clipping of a news that data of 540 million Facebook users have been exposed. It's from last year. So this is another example. So since I'm from India, so some popular Indian banking fiascos. So we trust banks a lot. We generally put all of our money, our parents, our family in banks. But if we actually see, then it's like very risky. So as you can see on the screen, so around $156 million of fraud have been happened in just from April to December in 2019 only in India. So if we'll talk about the world, then it will be much, much larger. And also we all know about the Great Recession, how the world banking system failed at that time. So there's no telling. Then if I were to summarize these things, then what are the actual problems in the existing systems? Okay, so one is lack of transparency. So for example, if we are putting our money in bank, or if suppose as I took the example of the vendor, so we don't exactly know that from where the fruits are coming to that vendor, or if we are depositing our money in bank, then what exactly bank is doing with it, to whom they are giving loan. There's no transparency. If something were to happen, then like we as end customers will never know then where the fault was actually. Then there are many security concerns, as we saw in the example of Facebook, that we are trusting these third parties with our data. But we are just like assuming that they are keeping it safe, that no one can hack it, or they themselves don't use it for any wrong purposes. But that is not always the case. And then central authority making all decisions, as we saw in LinkedIn and YouTube's case. And there are various unnecessary charges by intermediaries, because if any monopoly is attained, then people can't actually have a right to say much. They just have to pay the charges and all whatever the intermediaries are taking. Then, yeah. So what kind of system do we actually need? So we actually need a system which do not have any central authority. Because with central authority comes various other issues like the misuse of power and many others. And that system should be completely transparent, auditable, which means traceable. So each and everyone should be able to check going back that what exactly has happened in that particular system, all the transactions and all. Sorry. Then it should be fault tolerant. That means it should be able to it should be able to handle faults and attempts to hack or maybe these kind of things. Then this is just some imaginary characteristics that we need in an ideal system. But how can we achieve it? Because it's very difficult when we talk about these things in an absence of a central authority, because there is no one now to take all the decisions, right? For example, in the case of banks, when we are doing a transaction, so the bank is validating that whether that particular transaction is right or not wrong, whether you have, let's say you are doing a transaction of $5,000, but you have in your bank only $100, then who is validating that? So bank is validating that. So if you remove the central authority from the picture, then how exactly things will happen? So this we'll see. So blockchain is like one of the answers to those questions. Dive deeper in this presentation. So I'll just give you now a brief introduction to blockchain. So do any one of you have any idea, any rough idea of what blockchain is? If you can just type out in the comments. I'll just wait for a minute. If you have any idea, you can type out in comments. Okay, anyways, so I'll just give you a brief about it. So before diving deep into what blockchain actually is, let's see what blockchain is actually solving. Okay, so this is like a timeline of like in the 1400s, there was a knowledge gap. Like people didn't know anything what was happening around the world. Then came press. So press, newspapers and media, all these things. So that they just they filled this particular knowledge gap. Then came the gap of power. So there was like no engines present at that time, no cars, nothing. So in 1800, the engine solved the power gap and told people that yes, technology can do a lot of things. Then we all know about internet reduced the distance gap and connected people from all around the world. Then in the current scenario, there is another gap which blockchain is actually filling. So that gap is trust gap. So actually, as we discussed, that there's a lack of trust. Like we need to trust these third parties for our things, and a lot of times that trust has been broken. So like we are not able to understand how that trust gap can be filled. So blockchain can actually fill that trust gap. And if we talk about the market, then the market of this trust gap is $100 trillion. So it's a very huge market. So blockchain at a fundamental level maintains trust. How? We will see further. If I were to describe like blockchain in a single line, then blockchain is an immutable distributed ledger. Okay, so what that means? So it means is that first is immutable. So immutable means that this, if something is immutable, then that cannot be changed. All right, so suppose in case of a blockchain, so it is append only, right? You cannot, once anything written on top of a blockchain cannot be changed. You can only add to it. So it is immutable. We'll see how it is immutable. It uses cryptographic techniques and hashing to achieve immutability. Then it is distributed. Distributed means there is no central authority. No one is there who is governing all the things. It's a distributed system wherein only the community, the members in the network take all the decisions. And there is no central server or a central database where everything is stored. And it's a ledger. So ledger by ledger, you can, like the closest example is a bank passbook. So in your bank passbook, if you have ever checked or your bank transaction history, because nowadays everything has gone, digital. So you must have seen that. So it contains all the details of like all your transactions that has been happened. So it's kind of you can say that it is a ledger. Okay. Then. Okay. So then comes that in distributed, so we can say that blockchain is actually a peer-to-peer network. So as you can see that in the left-hand side, we have a traditional system wherein there's a third party where all the nodes, or we can say all the participants are dependent on it. Whereas in the right-hand side, there's blockchain, where there is no third party, and there's a distributed system wherein when all the nodes, all the participants are connected to each other. So if I were to give you an example of a peer-to-peer network, so you guys must have heard or used Torrent. Okay, so if you have not heard, you can check it out. So Torrent works on a peer-to-peer system. It do not have any central entity. For example, if we talk about BitTorrent, so BitTorrent do not have any central server or database where which you can access and download the movies or those things. So it is a peer-to-peer system wherein if you are downloading a movie, let's say from BitTorrent, then you are actually downloading from some other peers in the network. Okay, so that's a peer-to-peer network. So these are some of the characteristics of a blockchain. One is replication, which means that the database and everything, all the information, all the information has been replicated across the network. So it's not stored at any central place. There is no central central server or central database where all the things are stored and any hacker or anyone can come and just hack that particular server and get all the information, but it is actually replicated across the entire network. So suppose if you are a node, if you are a participant in a blockchain network, then you'll have the entire blockchain stored on your system. And similarly, every other participant will. Okay, then there is no central authority, as we have talked. And then comes irreversibility. So what this means is that, as we said, that blockchain is immutable. Okay, once you write anything to blockchain, you cannot change it. You can only add to the blockchain. So there irreversibility comes in, that if you cannot change anything, that means you cannot reverse anything. Okay, so then comes accessibility. So accessibility, by accessibility, what I mean is that, suppose in a general scenario, suppose you are ordering something from Amazon and the server of Amazon goes down, although they have very powerful servers, but there can be some situations for some time, for a minute or two, the server goes down due to some reasons. And so that means that the accessibility during that time is like you cannot access the server. Okay, but in case of blockchain, what happens is that because there is no central server, you can fetch data from multiple other peers. So it means that the problem of accessibility is resolved to a very greater extent, because now you don't have a single source, right? You have multiple sources in the network. You can take data from any one of them. So you don't have to be dependent on a single system. All right. Then comes time stamping. So time stamping, so in blockchain, what happens is that every data, every transaction that happens is time stamped. Okay, that just means that everything has a particular time, like for example, in your bank account. So every transaction has a particular time written in front of it, that this has happened at this particular time. So in blockchain, everything has a time stamp, every transaction. And then it uses cryptography. So it uses various techniques like hashing and others. We'll be talking about them as we go further. These are some of the blockchain use cases. Okay, so as like most of us think that blockchain is only used for cryptocurrencies, mostly Bitcoin. That's the wrong perspective that we all have. So just to clear that perspective, you can see that these are just some of the use cases of blockchain. It can be used in banking, it can be used in supply chain and healthcare, in governance, in advertising. Fake advertising things can be handled through blockchain. And in like supply chain, a lot of blockchain can provide a lot of help, a lot of credibility to the things. It can be used in banking. It can be used to write smart contracts for affiliate marketing in charities. It can be used, suppose you are donating your money to any XYZ trust, but you don't know where they are actually using that money. It's a possibility that it can be a fraud. So blockchain can handle all those things by adding on a layer of trust. Okay, so let's move on understanding how blockchain concepts actually work. So till now, if you guys have any queries, you can ask in the comments. Let me know. Okay, I think I can move on. There are not any queries that I can see. Okay, great. Okay, so let's move on into understanding how the blockchain actually works, some of the concepts of blockchain, some of the working. Let's see that. Okay, so blockchain is actually a hash pointer. So what do we mean by that? So as you can see, like the three blocks in the slide, and they are connected to each other. So this, you can assume this as a blockchain, wherein if you see into each block, then there's some data, there's a previous block hash pointer. Sorry. So as we can see that each block is connected to its previous block through a hash pointer. Okay, so what does that mean is that we take the entire contents of a block, we create its hash. What is hash? If you don't know, we'll be covering it, don't worry. So we take the entire block contents, we create its hash, and we store that particular hash in the next block's header. Okay, as you can see. So what happens with this is that hash is like your, you can say, a signature of that particular content. So if let's say you have 1 KB or 1 MB of content in the block, you create a hash of it. So hash is actually a very, you can say maybe it depends, but let's take an example. It's a 16-bit number. Okay, so that hash represents that 1 MB block. If you change even one character in that block, then the hash completely changes. So you can say it's like a signature of that block, or it represents that entire block. Okay, so if each block's hash is stored in their next block header. Okay, so what's the benefit of this is that suppose you go on changing on any of the block content, then the hash of the consequent block, the hash of that block stored in the consequent block's header changes, because that do not reflects back to the previous block anymore, because the content has been changed, right? So that link is break. So you can easily check out that if any block's content has been tampered with, then you can match it with the subsequent block's hash. If that does not matches, then you can clearly say that someone has tampered with it. Okay, so then comes encryption decryption. So I think you must have all studied about it in your college or university, but I'll just give you a brief again. So what happens is that suppose there's a plain text called "here's my private data." You encrypt it using some algorithms and a key, and it becomes into ciphertext, which is just a coded language, and which can be again used, which can be again decrypted by the receiver using another key or the same key, and you get again the plain text. So the process of converting plain text into ciphertext is encryption, and ciphertext to plain text is decryption. Okay, so there are two kinds of encryptions. One is symmetric and the other is asymmetric. So symmetric is one in which we see there are two keys used, one for encryption, one for decryption. So if we are using the same key to encrypt as well as to decrypt, then it is symmetric. And if we are using different keys to encrypt and to decrypt, then it is called asymmetric. So blockchain uses asymmetric encryption in the form of public and private key. So what are public and private key? Public key, you can understand it, let's say your username in any platform. So your username can be your public key, and your private key can be your password. So public key anyone can know, but private key only you should have access to. Okay, then there comes a concept of digital signatures. So what happens in a digital signature is that on a blockchain, suppose you are putting up a transaction. Okay, so what you do is that you, let's say X is sending to Y a transaction. So what X will do is that he or she will encrypt that particular transaction with Y's public key. Okay, X will encrypt using Y's public key, and then he or she will send it to the network, and it will be there on the network in the encrypted form, but no one will be able to decrypt it. Only Y will be able to decrypt it using his or her private key, because it was encrypted using the public key. So only Y's private key can unlock it. So Y uses his or her private key to unlock the message, to decrypt the message, and actually see the final content. So this is how the concept of digital signatures work. Then comes hashing. So what hashing exactly is, so as you can see in the example, that hashing is like on the left hand side, we have some input data which we are feeding to the hash functions, and we are getting some output. Okay, so suppose that we are feeding it a word called fox, then it converts it to a number, to a string of a particular size. Now suppose we are feeding it a sentence, then also it's giving the output of the same length, although it is completely changed. Then suppose we just change the word from runs, we add walks, the red fox walks across the ice. Then the hash is completely changed. Even if we just changed a single word in it, the hash is completely changed. So from this, we can conclude a few of the properties of hash function. So one is hashes are unique. So it means that, for any input, there is only one hash. Okay, so like there cannot be two hashes which are same if we feed the different inputs. They do not collide. They are almost collision free. Okay, so this is one property. Then there are deterministic and one way, which means is what this means is that you can create a hash from an input. Okay, you give an input and you create a hash, but you cannot track it back. I mean, if you have the hash, you cannot find the input unless you have that particular key which is required for doing it. So it is like a one way, deterministic, unique, collision free, and fixed length. Okay, that length can be anything. We just took an example in this case. Okay, then how is blockchain immutable? So as we have seen that each block stores the hash of the previous block. So in this example, you can clearly see that in the third block, suppose the original hash was starting with 9F86, something like this, which has been crossed. So it is stored in the next block, right? So it is stored in the next block. Now suppose you go to the third block and you try to change something. So as soon as you change something, the actual hash of the block is changed to this 40A00 thing. And now if you go on and match that whether this is the same hash in the next block, then you'll get to know that no, the hash in the next block is actually starting from 9F, but this block's hash is 40 something. So some tampering has been happened. So this can be figured out using this particular technique. Okay, then we come across consensus mechanisms. Okay, so what is consensus mechanisms? I'm not sure if you guys have heard about it. So in blockchain, it's like a backbone of the blockchain, consensus mechanisms. So in general terms, if I were to explain you, then consensus just means agreement. Agreeing to something is called consensus. So let's say in the case of blockchain, where we don't have a central entity, so how decisions are made or how we reach to a particular decision, like any decision, that whether a transaction is correct or not, whether we have to do an update in the system or what. So all those things are achieved using consensus. Okay, so suppose, for example, if we consider a network of the participants who are attending this session. Okay, so we all are in a blockchain system. Now we have to reach to a common agreement. Okay, so how can we reach that? So for doing that, consensus mechanisms are used in blockchain, and will not dive deep much into the details. So those are generally done through peer-to-peer validation. Okay, so like for example, Gillian in this example sends a transaction to Nick. Then how will the system verify that whether this transaction is right or wrong? So it's generally done using peer-to-peer validation, as I said. So everyone in the network, Gillian will share their transaction with everyone in the network, and the people will check the validity of that transaction. And if more than 51% of the network agrees to a decision, then that decision is final. So it's just very, very a rough idea. You can read more about it in detail. Okay, so moving ahead, do you have any other queries? You can just type out in the comments if you have any queries. Okay, great. No queries. So let's move on. So let's discuss about what Ethereum is and how can we create smart contracts. Okay, so Ethereum is like a decentralized platform. It's a blockchain, which you might have heard about. It's very popular next to Bitcoin. So it like introduced the concept of smart contracts. Till Bitcoin, Bitcoin is mostly used for cryptocurrency. Okay, it do not have many other use cases. You can use Bitcoin blockchain for other purposes, but it's not made in that way, so it's very difficult. So Ethereum first started the concept of smart contracts, you can say, and Vitalik is like one of the founders of Ethereum, and he's like very popular. And Ethereum has a like native asset or cryptocurrency called Ether, which is used to do all the transactions and handle everything on the Ethereum network. Okay, so what's the difference between Bitcoin and Ethereum? The difference is that, as I said, Bitcoin is just Bitcoin centric, used for cryptocurrency purposes. And whereas Ethereum has like a much wider range of applications, use cases. So it's a, you can say Turing complete language. It supports a Turing complete language, Ethereum, which we'll discuss about in this session. And it's like a platform for developing various decentralized applications. So what is exactly a smart contract? So smart contracts are like autonomous agents that are living on the Ethereum network. So they are just a piece of code which are deployed on the Ethereum blockchain or any other blockchain. And they react according to the things that were coded in. Okay, so they can react to the external world when they are poked by any transactions which any other smart contract or any other person can initiate. Or they can they can get activated automatically depending on the terms that has been coded in them. Okay, so each smart contract has their own Ether balance. They can store their own balance, and they have their own contract state and a permanent storage where they can store variables and any other things. So how do smart contracts actually work? So I guess you must have. You all must have used a vending machine. So in a vending machine, there is no need of any other person to be involved, right? So it is just self-sufficient. You just go, you swipe your card, or you put in some money, and you choose that which of the product you want, and you just get it directly, right? So you can relate it with a smart contract. That's smart contracts work on a similar principle, that you can just give some information and smart contracts functions will work accordingly and give you some output, initiate some transaction, or can do anything without the involvement of any other third party. So in Ethereum, as I said, the smart contracts have their own accounts. So there are actually two types of accounts. One is contract accounts, which smart contracts own, and the second is externally owned accounts, which actually the nodes or the other people on the network own. Okay, so these are two different types of accounts. Then let's see how can you write your first smart contract. Okay, so talking about this, so we'll just do a hands-on on a banking contract. All right, it's a, like a very simple contract. Even if you don't know the language which is used to write this particular contract, which is called Solidity. So Solidity is a language which is used to write smart contracts on Ethereum blockchain. So there are multiple other blockchains. There are thousands of other blockchains in the world currently. And some of them have their different languages, their different smart contract languages, and they're trying to achieve different goals. So you can, I'm just giving you a brief introduction of Ethereum because it's the most popular one in the current scenario. And you can start your journey with Ethereum, or you can also explore some other blockchains, and you can try them out like Blockstack, Tezos, Matic Network, and there are many others. You can just search that what are some of the most popular blockchains where I can start. I'll prefer that if you can start with Ethereum, it would be great, because the reason is it has a very good ecosystem, a very good developer community which you can refer to in case you get any queries or you need any help. So taking it further, so if we are making a bank contract, then let's first understand what does a bank actually need. Okay, so in a bank, you generally deposit your money, or you withdraw your money, or you check your balance. These are just the three very basic functions that a bank need to do. Okay, so we'll include these three functions and see how these will actually work. Okay, so this is Solidity. As I said, you might think that this is very complex, but actually it is very easy. So we'll go through this contract step by step in this session. So let's see the first step. So if you can see right hand side the code, so it is starting with Pragma Solidity. And then 0.6.11. So it is basically defining the compiler version of the Solidity. So this particular contract is using 0.6.11 version of the Solidity language. Okay. So we have just defined it. Then we are starting with the contract. So it's contract simple bank. Simple bank is just the name of the contract. You can name it anything, the bank A, bank XYZ, simple banking system or anything. Then contract simple bank, then we are starting it. Then we are declaring mapping address to uint, which is unsigned integer, then private balances. Okay, so let's understand what is this. So mapping is a data structure, okay, and then it is we are saying that it is mapping from addresses to unsigned integers, and it is private. Private means that no other contracts will be able to access this particular variable balances. Okay, balances is the name, you can change it. So we have created a mapping called balances, which is mapping what? Which is mapping addresses to unsigned integers. So if I were to guess from this, then addresses is the address of the person whose balance will be unsigned integer. So address is the address of a person, and unsigned integer is his or her balance. Okay, so we have created a mapping which is public, which is private. Then we have an address public owner. So then we have created a variable called owner, which whose type is address. It means it can store addresses, and it is public. That means any other contract can also access it. Okay, so I hope this is clear. So moving ahead, so one more thing. So we have declared these two variables, balances and owner, outside of any functions, right? So these are state variables. So if we have defined it inside of any function, then those were valid only throughout the function. And if we go out of the function, then those variables will not be valid anymore. So these are state variables. They'll be valid through the entire life of the contract. Okay. So then the next thing is event. So after this, we have included the event. So as you can see in the code, event log deposit made, and then there are two parameters. One is address, account address, and the second is uint amount. So why these events are created? So events are mostly created to connect smart contracts to the external world. So suppose, for example, you have an application for your bank, and you want, whenever you do a transaction, whenever, let's say, you deposit some money, you get a notification in the app. So events will help to connect the smart contracts with the app, so that whenever you make a deposit, the event is triggered, which informs the application front end that this has been happened, and you are shown a message or anything that this amount has been deposited. So we have made an event whose name is log deposit made. You can change this name, and then it accepts two parameters. It is accepting one, the address, and second, the amount. So we'll see how it is used in the contract. Then we have a constructor like any other, like constructors in any other language. It's the same concept. So we have defined it public, and inside it, what we are doing is owner equals message dot sender. So message dot sender is a predefined keyword, which means that whoever has sent that particular message. So in this case, since we have used it in constructor, so constructor is only constructor only runs once when that particular contract is made. So whoever has made and deployed that contract on blockchain, okay, that is referred to as the message.sender here. So we have created a variable called owner, and we are storing the address in that particular owner. Okay, then comes the next step, which is your function deposit. So how will you deposit the money actually? So this function, if you just read out the code, so it is function deposit public payable returns. Okay, so it is public, that is clear. Anyone can see this function and use it to interact with the bank. The function's name we have given deposit, it can be anything. Then it is payable. So we declare the functions payable in which we want to accept some money. So since this is a deposit function, which people will use to deposit some money, so that is why we have declared it payable. This is a keyword. Okay, then comes returns. So returns unsigned integer. So it's one thing. So this function will return an unsigned integer. Okay, that will be the final balance of the user. So if we see further, then there is a statement written: require balances message dot sender plus message value should be greater than balances message dot sender. So this balances is the mapping that we have created in the beginning. Okay, so balances message.sender will give you the actual balance of a message sender. Okay, so what this is checking is that the message value, which means the amount that the user has chosen to deposit, it should not be negative. It should always be positive, right? Because if it's negative, that means your balance will be reduced actually. So this require statement is just checking that if balances of a particular message sender plus the message value that he has sent is greater than the actual message value, that means the message value is positive. So it's just checking that. Then what we are doing is we are increasing the balance of the message sender by the amount of the message value. So the message value is actually when you try to interact with this particular deposit function, then you will pass on a value. That value is like how much amount you want to deposit. So this is the message value we are talking about here. So the balance will be increased by that amount, and an event has been emitted. So we created the event log deposit made, right? So we are emitting that event here that yes, a deposit has been made, and we are passing two values, that the message sender, that is the address on which the deposit has been made, and the message value, the amount of deposit that has been made. So it will be emitted. You can catch this particular event using your front end or whatever, and you can display it. Okay, then we are returning the balances. We are returning the balance of the message sender. Okay, so as we have seen at the top of the function that we have written returns unsigned integers. So through this statement return balances, we are actually returning this. So we can use it to check like whether the balance has been updated or not. Then moving ahead, so this is the function withdraw. Okay, we have seen the function deposit. Now comes the function withdraw. So in withdraw, it's accepting a parameter which is unsigned withdraw amount. So you have to specify that what amount you want to withdraw. Then it's public, okay, because anyone can use it to withdraw money from his or her account. Then it is returning an unsigned integer remaining balance. So as you may have seen in the previous example, that we have just written returns unsigned integer, and in this example we are also giving a name, unsigned integer remaining balance. So it's totally optional. You can give a name or you cannot. It depends on you. Then if we see in this function what exactly is happening, then at first we are just doing a basic check that whether the withdraw amount is actually lesser than the amount in the account balance, that is balances message.sender should be greater than the withdraw amount. So like one more thing that might be confusing you is that the message.sender. So message.sender is different for each case when we were using it in constructor. So constructor is generally called during the time when the contract is deployed, and that particular message is sent by the contract creator. So in that case, message.sender is the contract creator. And in further cases, let's say in this withdraw case, so whoever has initiated this particular transaction, whoever has called this particular function withdraw, that will be message.sender. Okay, so if it will just check that whether the withdraw amount is actually that much amount is present in the requester's account or not. If it's true, then what it will do is first it will reduce that particular balance from his or her account. It's a balance message sender minus equals withdraw amount, which means that balances message sender equals to balances message sender minus withdraw amount. So it's the complete statement. It's just written in a short form. And once that particular variable is updated of the balances, then the actual transfer is taking place. So how that is taking place? We have written if not message sender dot send withdraw amount. So message sender message dot sender dot send withdraw amount is used to actually withdraw the amount, and we have written not message dot sender. So it means that in case this particular withdrawing fails due to any reason, it can be XYZ, any reason your internet is not working or the bank is service is not available. So if that fails, so this if condition becomes true. If this if conditions become true, then we are again increasing the balance variable. Why? Because the sending has actually failed. And then finally, we are returning the balance message.sender. So one question may pop in your mind that why are we first decreasing the balance and then checking and then increasing it? Why don't we just send it, and if it fails, then we'll not increase it. We don't do anything, and if it passes, then we'll reduce it. But that generally is not done due to a potential hack possibility here. So I'll not go much into its details, but if you do that, then there is a possibility that an attacker can use a recursive call and can use to hack the system and withdraw amount like even larger than what actually is present or what is allowable. So that can be done. That's why we have not used it. So just for a brief, now you can understand this particular contract, that first we have just started the contract, simple bank, declared some of the variables, declared an event, then we have defined the constructor, then on the right hand side we have three functions. First one is deposit, that we have already seen, withdraw we have already seen, and then the function balance view. This is not covered. This is just a very simple function which is just used to view balance. So you can just go and call this function and view your particular balance. Okay. So its name is balance, it is public, it is returning an unsigned integer, and there is a keyword called view. So view, we define the those functions as view, in which we are not changing anything to the blockchain. So for example, in deposit and in withdraw, we were actually changing the balances mapping, right? You are changing the balances mapping, so it was actually updating the blockchain state. So we have not defined them as view, but this particular function is not changing anything, it's just fetching some data. So that's why we have defined it as view. Okay, so like this was just a basic example. So you can try creating it, compiling it, and deploying it actually on this development environment called Remix. So you can just go and search for remix.ethereum.org, and you can try out different contracts or try out this particular contract, and you will get an idea of how things are exactly happening. So if you want the code of this particular thing that we discussed just now, you can find the code on our GitHub repository. You can go to zubi-io on GitHub, and there you'll find blockchain elements workshop, and inside that we have bank.sol contract. Okay. So you can just see that, check that out again, see this video again, and you'll get a more clarity if you're not able to understand much right now. So I have a very interesting task for you that will help you to actually understand these things. So just go through this contract once. Think of what else do we need in our bank. It can be very simple things. Okay, just think of those things. You can add on, it can be a new function, or it can be a check in the existing functions only. Okay, so you can do that. Think about it. Okay, you can read some more basics of Solidity on the Solidity docs. You just have to Google Solidity docs, and you can just read it within a few hours. Some basics you can read, and you'll be able to get a hold of the things. And then you have to think of some relevant functionalities which can be added in this particular contract. And you can add it to this particular GitHub repository. You just have to fork the contract in your own GitHub repository, make the changes in your repository, and then create a pull request. Okay, and you can do this, and this activity will actually help you to implement something and understand how things are actually happening. Then if you need these slides, then I can share all these slides, and you can join our Telegram community, as I mentioned. Okay, so for that, you can either just go to https://t.me/zubi_io, or you can search for zubi_io on Telegram. So this is Zubi's community. We are building India's largest emerging technology ecosystem, and you can join it. I can share the slides, and if you have any further follow-up questions after this session, you can ask me there. You can find me there as a_yogesh. Okay. Then if you guys are tech enthusiasts, then I'll just suggest you to check this out. It's an emerging technology conference that Zubi is organizing. You can check out at letcon.zubi.io. Okay, and it's like a biggest emerging technology conference, and it's a virtual conference, so you can attend it from the comfort of your homes. And just check it out on letcon.zubi.io. So this was it from my side. If you want to connect with me, you can either join the Zubi community and find me there. You can mail me at yogesh@zubi.io, or you can connect me on LinkedIn. My username is yogesh-agarwal-. And if you want the slides or any other help, feel free to contact me anywhere. And yeah, that's all from my side. If you guys have any questions, you can ask me. Or if not, we can conclude the session. Okay, Sheris, are you here?
Hi, thank you so much, Yogesh. For everyone, as Yogesh mentioned, please connect with him on Telegram, on LinkedIn. I'm sure he'll be ready to answer all your questions. And also, if you want the slide deck, please add him on Telegram. Thank you so much, Yogesh, for sharing so much today. This was such an insightful talk. And yeah, we'll be taking a quick intermission before our game next up by Harshal. So stay tuned, everybody. Thank you, Yogesh.